Kurt, if he had offered you nothing, would you have done it?
Probably. De Tocqueville talked about America, right?
To be a pastime, you need to transcend the sport. America is not a one-size-fits-all place.
By the way, do you know where we got the seventh inning stretch?
Oh, you don't get it.
Oh, I get it. He was the only person in history who was president and then became Supreme Court Chief Justice. You know, if you meet someone and their name is Chip? Hello, everyone. Today, we are flipping, flopping, jumping, jacking, everything, because it's a new episode of Smart Drivel. This is Kurt Schneider.
And I'm John Ellenthal, and this is Smart Drivel. And without taking everybody too deep inside the kitchen here, this is the first episode, Kurt, we've ever recorded when we were not in the same room. So I think we're going to talk about America's favorite pastimes today. How does that sound to you, Kurt?
American pastimes. That's great. I'm all in.
Okay, that's great.
I bet you that was one of them. Finding the old swimming hole, and on a hot day, everyone says, let's go all in, and you're getting a rope swing and jumping in. I think that was a pastime.
If you define a pastime as a pleasant way to pass time, then certainly swinging off a rope from a tree into the swimming hole in Mayberry, North Carolina, certainly would qualify as one.
But I will tell you, however, though, when I was about 12 years old, I think it was early April. Or end of March.
That's too early for a swimming hole.
And we were in South Salem, New York, and we were at family friend's house for the day. And my brother and I, who was probably 14, or maybe I was 11 and he was 13, we went out in a boat with the son of the family we were visiting. I think he was 16 or 17. And he said, if I stripped down to my tighty whities and I did the rope swing into the water, he would give me a brick of firecrackers.
Wow. Offering someone a brick of firecrackers is the equivalent of offering, you know, the keys to Fort Knox to a 12-year-old.
So I did it.
Kurt, if he had offered you nothing, would you have done it?
Probably. But I got a brick of firecrackers out of it. And I sold them each, I think, for 75 cents a pack.
You're always very enterprising. That's good. So it's hard to hear the term America's favorite pastimes and not think of baseball. And I'm going to draw a distinction here, Kurt, between a pastime, which is, like we said, a pleasant way to pass time.
Knitting.
And the proper noun.
Square dancing.
America's favorite pastime.
Grilling.
Because I'm going to take a very strong position here, Kurt, that America's favorite pastime, capital P, proper noun, is baseball. It is, after all, called America's favorite pastime, and it didn't get that name by accident.
So I'm not going to disagree as long as we can just change one word.
Favorite?
Nope.
Okay, what word do you want to change?
Change is to was, and I'm with you.
Ah, so you believe that America's favorite pastime was baseball, and now the pastime torch has been passed to what?
Football, of course, and probably 30 or 40 years ago. This is not something that had just been passed.
Okay. So to qualify as America's favorite pastime, Kurt, the pastime has to be so intertwined with American history, American culture, American identity, that takes decades and centuries to happen, that kind of intertwining. It's almost like the double helix. It's that intertwined. What are you saying has happened with baseball that it's been replaced by football?
I think exactly what you just said. I think a pastime has got to reflect the DNA, if you will, of the country. So the DNA of America. And football is manifest destiny, right? It is trying to get from one end of the field, one end of the continent to the other. And that's my destiny to get there.
Like when the Giants and Dodgers left New York and moved to California, that kind of manifest destiny?
But I'm talking about the game itself and the way it's played. And when you're sitting around and you have 9 innings and you have to, each person gets to have 3 outs on either side.
Okay, so hang on a second.
We have de Tocqueville talked about America, right? When he wrote Democracy.
I knew
America.
That Alexander de Tocqueville would come up today. I just knew it.
Well, when he talked about it in the mid-19th century, he talked about this innate ability to crave freedom, to try to make your own path, to try to figure out the best way to burst through a metaphoric line of life. That was distinctly American. And that's what you do in football.
So the fact that you are breaking through and going from one end to the other is what. So let's distinguish between football being a great sport, and I am a football fan, so don't get me wrong, and something that transcends sports, a pastime. Look, baseball is a sport, basketball is a sport, football is a sport. You know those things, right?
Good for you, John.
Thank you very much. But baseball transcends. To be a pastime, you need to transcend the sport. So football is played on a uniform grid of 100 yards long. Baseball stadiums, baseball fields are played on fields that are different shapes, different sizes, different colors, like Americans themselves. America, America is not a one size fits all place like a football field is.
By the way, do you know where we got the seventh inning stretch? This actually plays into your point.
I'm not sure. Did we sing God Bless America in the seventh inning stretch?
No, but I mean, how did it come about?
I don't know. You're asking me and I'm asking you.
William Howard Taft, President of the United States.
Actually, he was the first president to throw out the first pitch on opening day.
So he was a big baseball fan. The problem was,
I believe.
The problem was he also weighed over 300 pounds. So sitting for a long amount of time for him was not good for someone of his incredible girth. So he couldn't take it at one point, and he had to stand up in the middle of the seventh inning. And when he did that, because he was president, everyone else had to stand up because that's what you do around the president, and hence was born the seventh inning stretch.
So if he had stood up in the middle of the fifth inning, it would be called the fifth inning stretch?
Yes.
In more modern times, during the seventh inning stretch, especially during an important playoff or World Series game that's shown nationally, during the seventh inning stretch, they do a beautiful rendition of God Bless America, further evidence that the relationship between baseball and America is so intimate that it transcends the sport to make it our national pastime, then and future.
They sing God Bless America?
When was the last time you watched a baseball game?
Isn't it America the Beautiful they sing?
Well, they sing before the game, of course, they sing the Star Spangled Banner, the national anthem. During the seventh inning stretch, it is tradition, especially during very big games, to have someone come out and sing God Bless America. You're arguing that it's America the Beautiful.
No, I'm just arguing that I haven't been in a long time. You know why? And if I have gone, I don't last to the seventh inning because baseball.
But whether it's America the Beautiful or God Bless America, we're not talking about whether the sport is boring or not. We're talking about when it is not, by the way. All you've communicated by saying it's boring is that you don't get it.
No, I get it.
You don't get it.
Oh, I get it.
So Jackie Robinson,
hardest thing to
breaking the color barrier in 1947, that is part of our national history. Come on, you don't have that stuff in football. Football is, which I enjoy as a sport, is not a pastime. A pastime is something you can enjoy every day that has a leisurely pace to it, like a long walk. Whereas in football, it just happens. You know what? I'll tell you what. Baseball starts in the spring when everything is born. Football starts during the barren winter time. Further evidence that baseball is a pastime and football is only a sport.
Okay. I think that is one man's decided opinion, and I'm glad that you have that. I am not arguing any of that. And in fact, I think you make excellent points,
You called
points,
it
John.
Boring, and well, you said that football said has replaced baseball as America's pastime.
I should not have said it was boring. I think it has some attributes that are no longer in sync with American societal
So what's changed in American society?
Right, so short attention spans.
Huh? Say that again?
Very funny. Uh-huh. Short attention spans, desire for action at all times, a need some
action at all times. If you were to put the action in a football game, you know, cut out all the stuff that happens in between, piece it together, you have 11 minutes of action spread across 3 hours and 15 minutes.
You're right. It's a good point.
Okay. So,
by the way, Howard Taft.
Yeah.
He was the only person in history who was president and then became Supreme Court Chief Justice.
You know what? I did not know that.
Yeah.
That's actually that's an excellent fact. Was it immediately after his presidency ended,
so
or was there a big gap?
So he was Teddy Roosevelt's chosen successor in 1908. And then Teddy left in great fanfare. He could have run again because he was first president because McKinley was shot. And so Teddy became the youngest U.S. president, not elected president, but the youngest U.S. president. He's president, wins in 04, decides not to run in 08, then all of a sudden does not like what Taft is doing. He forms the Bull Moose Party in 1912, which actually separates the Republican Party, which allows Woodrow Wilson, the former president of Princeton University, to come in to be president. Taft goes off to Yale Law School, and then he gets named a Supreme Court justice, then becomes Supreme Court Chief Justice in the 20s, so a while after being president, or so I think.
Well, we now know what your favorite pastime is. Presidential history circa the early 1900s, although McKinley took office, what, in 1898?
1896.
Okay. So you know what baseball has, getting back to pastimes for a moment, that football doesn't have, unless you correct
me? Talk in between pitches about history so you can talk about it. Oh.
No, but that is nice that we could have a nice conversation while enjoying the game at the ballpark, while having a beer and
no
a dog.
Helmets on baseball players. You get to see them.
That's a big deal. That's another reason why baseball, you can actually see their face, see their expressions, identify with their experience, know how they're feeling, as opposed to being trapped behind that face mask in football.
Babe Ruth calling a shot. Unbelievable.
In the World Series against the Cubs. All right. So you know what, baseball has a song. Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Does football have a song other than Go, Go, Rah, Rah, Kill, Kill?
Yes. AC/DC, Highway to Hell.
Yes. And that's They're often seen together. How about the slogan, the Chevy slogan from the early 1970s?
Football, American pie.
As American as baseball, hot dogs, apple pie, and Chevrolet.
Yeah. By the way, we already talked about pies.
That's what happens with the. I remember that, actually. And
so listen, I think you're.
Now I'm thinking about pie.
Everything you're saying, I don't disagree with. In fact, I think baseball does have something that is in the fibers of Americans and Americana, and it reflects it. All I'm saying is football today better reflects where we are today than baseball. And there's something so beautiful about baseball, I get. But we crave in violence, we crave hitting, we crave contact. That you get all of that in football. It's the gladiators in us that comes out, right? It's in our very essence of being.
Well, it clearly appeals to us at a very base level, and it's probably America's most popular sport. But I think to be a pastime, I think you have to transcend the confines of sports and be intertwined with the culture and the moment in history. Like during the Great Depression, I mean, baseball was a great escape from daily life. And it's been that way through, you know, every major period of hardship. After 9/11, the return of baseball, and it was a deeply emotional and national experience for many.
But
so look, I love football.
We've had some great people like Gerald Ford, football player at Michigan. Right.
Michigan.
We had Byron Whizzer White, who was a Supreme Court justice, who was an unbelievable football player.
Any relationship to Danny White, the former Cowboys quarterback who replaced Roger Staubach?
There was a guy by the name of Elroy Crazy Legs Hirsch. How great is that?
That is a great nickname. Did you ever have a nickname, Kurt? Why don't you tell
That's
our
okay.
listeners
That's
what
you're... Right. They can ask around and find it. But it had to do actually with my lack of playing time I got as a football player in college on the varsity team. And it happened to rhyme with my last name. So it was Schneider, the bench rider, which got shortened to Rider, which I'll take. So, and you, nickname?
You know what? I've never had a lot of nicknames. I had red hair for a long time until I went to college. Sometime in college, I lost it, apparently. And people would call me Johnny Red in some
but
cases.
But not Rusty.
And no, I never got Rusty. Well, that made me think of the National Lampoon Vacation movies, which were so funny. And then when I was coaching my kids in Little League, you know, folks, you know, and emails became, you know, you became known by your email handle. And my email was jellenthal@whatever.com. And the kids thought it would be fun to shorten Jellenthal to Jelly. So I was called Coach Jelly for some time.
I like that. I'm going to call you Jelly from now on.
Well, there's a benefit of this conversation.
You know, I was talking to someone about this the other day. I just found out about 10 years ago, but recently, you know, if you meet someone and their name is Chip, So I met a guy by the name of Chip. And I said, "Ah, Chip, is that short for Charles?" He said, "No, his first name was something like Howard." And I said, "How does that work?" And he said, "Well, you're not from the South, are you?" And I said, "No, why?" He said, "Well, in the South, it works like this. If you have the same name as your father, you're called Chip, as in chip off."
Like a chip off the old block?
If you have the same name as your father and your grandfather, you're called Trip, as in you're the third.
Wow, Trip.
And
wow, this is quite the naming convention.
If you have the same name as your grandfather, but not your father, you're called Skip.
Skip the
generation. So now when you meet someone whose name is Skip, it's not because it's short for Scupper or something. It's because he has the same name as his grandfather.
Wow.
And Chip.
Where did you learn this, Kurt? Because this is quite fascinating.
I learned this from the guy whose name is Chip when I asked him if it was short for Charles.
Is there any chance he was messing with you? Because that's a great story. But you think that is true of all the people out there, and most of them that are called Skip or Chip or Trip?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And where does this, you said it's in the South. Is there a northernmost boundary for this
no,
tradition?
No, because the diaspora of Americans is such.
That's an excellent word.
Such that we don't have as much regional sort of ethnocentrism and borders as we used to. So people from the North have gone to the South. People from the South have gone to the North. And
yeah, they call them carpetbaggers.
Well, I meant more recently. So
That's another reason why baseball is the national pastime, is that, you know, unlike football, there are minor leagues, several levels of minor leagues all over America in small towns. So everyone can have their own local team that they can root for and be a part of and go watch. Bull Durham. That's a great movie. You think it stood the test
of
time?
Absolutely. Ready for this? Candlesticks.
So, before we get to Candlesticks, I remember showing my kids Bull Durham probably, I don't know, 10, 12 years ago. And we're a big baseball family that may have come out somehow in this episode. And both of my kids played baseball, so it was always a big part of daily life. And I was so excited to show them Bull Durham, which I consider to be one of the great baseball movies ever made. And I played it for them. And they were looking at me like, "What is wrong with you? It did not age as well as I thought it had." I was disappointed.
You know what else doesn't age as well as you think it have, and you're really disappointed about? Caddyshack. Awesome movie for our generation. It's too slow. You know what? Caddyshack is to movies today, like Fast and Furious, as baseball is to football in terms of pastime.
I see what you did there.
Brought it all back.
So there's an intensity and an action and a ferocity and a velocity and a violence that speaks to who we are as a culture now. The first Super Bowl, I think, was like 1967. The first World Series was probably like 1902 or 1903. Football is going to have to do it a little longer before we're starting to talk about football as America's pastime.
I think you make a good distinction, by the way, between pastime and popularity. So I'm with you on this. And this is the second time in all of our podcasts that I'm quasi-agreeing with you.
Yeah, well, you know what? That's a big step for us, and it's a big step for the podcast. So are there other movies? Animal House, which when we were kids was, I mean, that was an outrageous movie. I mean, that, for those times, I mean, that raised the bar. And I think by today's standards, society has become a bit more vile in some ways than it was. And I think that that would probably be a ho-hum for kids today.
I think you're probably exactly right. And I think that's probably true with a bunch of movies, which is very interesting. I think since we're kind of out of time today, that could be a topic for another podcast. Movies, do they stand the test of time? And looking at movies that we thought were terrific. And we can also even look generations before that, right? So where does Gone with the Wind fit in the whole?
Frankly, Kurt, I don't get
it. Very well done, Rhett.
So listen, I was recently a part of a text conversation with a half a dozen people. I don't know how it started exactly, but someone published their top 10 movies of all time. And subsequently, we each had to publish our own. And that is a no kidding around hard thing to do. And everybody's list had great movies on it, but they were very different lists. So I look forward to discussing.
Terrific.
Movies with
well,
you,
I would say batters up, or how do we end a game of baseball? The end, no time end.
Let's throw a yellow flag because that's entertaining.
Okay. I like both sports. And unfortunately, right now, we can't watch either. But
See, that's because this podcast has a time limit like football. So it doesn't have that ambling pace that allows you to pass time pleasantly.
But it allows you to
Kurt,
stop.
Very nice to see you. I look forward to when we can do this in the same room again.
And together. To all of our wonderful listeners, we hope you enjoy this. And we look forward to your recommendations of topics that we should speak on next. Okay, everyone. Signing off. This is Kurt Schneider.
John Ellenthal.
We promise the drivel.
We hope for
Bye,
the smart.
Everyone.